I've never been to Nasitok. Is it very cold? What creatures wander the tundra? How are your leaders chosen?
Do you always ask this many questions?
Well, that's just to get us started. Let me get out some parchment for notes.
Ask whatever you want. If I don't know, I'll make something up.
Welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind, everyone. This is the RPG chick. I don't know if you saw right at the very end of last episode. There's a wanted criminal who showed up at our stronghold. By the name of Neri the Deft Hand. What do we do? Send escort. Payoff. Send. What is send escort? I can't find out about this stuff. Let's pay him off. I guess that's it. Okay. Just want to see if these guys have anything to say. This guy in here, I forget his name.
No problem.
I'll grant you that animancy has had its failures, Balreach among them. But does that warrant attacks on innocent practitioners? Superstitious kith have spilled their share of blood.
That's no comparison. Animancers have the advantage of education, and with that comes authority and responsibility.
I have to say, it's wonderful to have someone to debate with. You'd think they'd be more welcoming of it at the lore college.
Or we could enjoy a glass of wine and a comfortable silence.
Yeah, I headed the wrong way. I want to go there, back to Brackenbury. Okay. Has the news spread yet? Guess these guys don't know that we killed Penhelm and a bunch of his men. Let's go to House Dominel. There's only this and the sanitarium left in this section, this district, so. We go. Greetings. Dominel Dorman. Let's see what you got back there, little treasure.
Hail, traveler.
The burly guard eyes you warily. I don't recognize you. What business do you have with House Dominel? Attack. I'm just here to loot the place and kill anyone in my way. Tell me about House Dominel. It's an old and respected family. Much of Defiance Bay's prosperity is due to Dominel business activities. Now, do you have any further business here? Farewell. I will see you out. What? Hey! I don't want to look around in there.
Gods keep you.
We can't. Alright. Can't even get in the stinking place. Well, that's annoying. Okay. On to the last place in Brackenbury. The sanitarium. Maybe they'll be crazy enough to let us in. Hmm. Hail, insane people. Sometimes we get people in here trying to make trouble for the animancers. I can't imagine why that would be. It just doesn't make any sense to me. Here's an animancer here. Here's a Verna. Warden, an animancer from the Republic's Bancello, has requested a visit. This talks? Extend a formal invitation. See to it that the necessary preparations are made. Of course. Huh. This thing talks. Okay. Halt. Animancy means progress and experimentation. Unfortunately, that makes some people uncomfortable. Verna. Oh, another past thing. You sense a strange divide in this woman's soul, an unnatural boundary between two opposed wills. You see the woman pausing by a roadside to hand something to the driver of a stopped wagon. These herbs should help with this party's sickness, she tells him. He can find more along the road, easy to spot with their serrated leaves, but avoid the ones with the green berries. It's a different species, toxic. He thanks her and offers her coin, but she waves him off, explaining that she is merely doing what her order asks of her. Sorry, guys. He nods, and she heads off down the road as he begins to hungrily consume the herb. You see the woman searching alongside the road now, the wagon just up the path, and you realize you have skipped backward in her memory. She sets eyes on a plant with serrated leaves and green berries. She picks several handfuls, tearing the berries off one by one and throwing them to the ground. She nudges them off the path into the brush, quickly with her boot, without looking down. Ooh. Spooky. As if to hide them from her own sight before striding back toward the wagon, hands outstretched. You're a bad person. The head warden of the sanitarium is a statue. Quite remarkable. The animancer straightens his robes and gives you a nod. They say the worst of the patients are kept locked up below. The table is set with an assortment of leaflets and booklets with titles like Practical Benefits of Animancy and Soul Adjustment for the Well-Adjusted Soul. Look at these, all these comfy couches. I definitely want to look at these books, can I?
I shall be quiet as a calm sea.
Wow. Too many people. Stinking people. I'm telling you. Yarmid. Another history. You see a dark room with garish furnishings, a large bed covered with pillows, several couches, and expensive rugs. This man is sitting in a chair, pushed against the wall of the room opposite the door. He is dressed in dark clothes with a black cloak wrapped around his shoulders, its hood pulled close around his face. Shadows fall across him, the darkness rendering him virtually invisible. Two other men wait in the darkness with him, watching the door. All three are motionless. Noise from the crowded common room below echoes up through the floorboards. The handle rattles. A man staggers in, dragging a young woman with him. The two standing men exchange a quick glance, one of them tilting his head and shrugging only slightly before jumping to the task at hand. One steps forward, grabbing the girl's wrist, wrenching it from her escort's hold with one hand while pushing the door closed with the other. Then that hand is over the girl's mouth before she is even aware she is in someone else's arms. He takes a dagger from its place on his belt and draws it across her neck. He holds her still, waits for the struggles to stop. The other standing man has already subdued their target, now tied to a chair, arms and legs bound with a rag stuffed in his mouth. The girl, no longer moving, is placed under the bed, the man who dealt with her taking his place beside the other. They stare down the man screaming against the cloth, but the muffled sound is unheard over the raucous noise of the crowd below. One of the men begins murmuring softly, putting his hand under the chin of the man in the chair. There is a brief flash of light, and the man stops struggling, a suddenly placid look in his eyes. The two captors ask various questions that the bound man answers happily. After they finish, the two look to the man sitting against the wall. He has not moved, as the events transpired before him, but only sat, silently observing everything as it happened. He stands, holding the cloak closed around himself, and nods to the two men. He then walks to the door, opens it only far enough to allow himself to exit, and then leaves them to finish their task. We see quite a few Brackenbury locals for treatment. It helps fund our research. Feel free to look around. You might be able to see a demonstration. I wouldn't mind being better armed, so what if it makes the clients a little nervous? You're welcome to browse. The spread of knowledge is a healthy thing, don't you agree? I do agree, but I want to take these books with me. What Your Soul May Be Trying to Tell You. I guess that's the title of a book there. Alright, let's talk to this statue here. Head Warden Ethelmore. A well-maintained statue of a middle-aged man presides over the room, looking down unblinking over the bustle of hurried academics pestered by the hopeful desperate. A strong warmth emanates from it that you could sense from across the room. There is a human soul stored beneath the stonework. You feel its attention turned towards you. Another person trapped in Adra, or willingly trapped in Adra. Too bad there's no voice acting here. It has been some time since a watcher graced these halls. His voice echoes deeply, rumbling the floor beneath you. I am envious of your natural insights, traveler. I can only imagine how it might have helped my work in life. Now, what is it that has brought you to my sanitarium? I'm curious as how you've come to be in your present state. In the statue, you mean? Well, he laughs. I was old, and it seemed wrong to me. A lifetime spent in pursuit of discovery, only to lose it all in death. Somewhere, someday, I would wake up in a new body, none the wiser, and pursue a different course entirely. All that experience wasted. If we are ever to unearth the principles behind our existence, it will be in spite of our condition. Of that, I am quite sure. To live on as part of something I helped build seemed to me a better legacy than what nature had in store. The transfer itself was quite simple as our techniques go, and for that I am grateful. Playing with souls is far easier to accept when they are not your own. I do miss being able to take an active role in the scholarly efforts here. Now and again, one of our animancers will humor me and consult over some problem, but they are a jealous breed and are too often afraid to collaborate. If you are considering it yourself, I can tell you that it isn't for the easily bored. Tell me about the sanitarium. A history lesson? This is a rare pleasure. Most come in here only concerned with cheating death in one way or another. We are an old institution, as Deerwood goes. This is our 94th year. As with many cities, the growth of Defiance Bay brought with it a host of problems. One of the worst was those born with, shall we say, ill-favored souls come to populate the streets in droves. Thus, the sanitarium. Brackenbury was a natural fit. It was growing, but there was also a lot of money here back then. This place owes its survival to the curiosities of the wealthy more than anything, I think. Our founding came at a time of great suspicion and animancy, much like today. So much progress has been lost to the mishaps of a few careless practitioners. But in time it was forgotten, as all things are. Since then we have been at the forefront of animancy's resurgence. We have played host to many gifted researchers and pushed the boundaries of our knowledge in ways never thought possible. Some of the first safe transferences were done here, and we have pioneered work in soul purification, lineage analysis, preservation. It's really quite a list, if you'll pardon my pride. Today it's... well, I can't say it's exactly the same. They've been some push to shut us down. It comes from Deerwood's most excitable denizens, whose minds are more passionate than thoughtful, I'm afraid. People see this legacy, and they see it involves something they don't understand, so it's natural for them to suspect people whose understanding exceeds theirs. It looks to them like we're hiding something. We have a representative in the palace this very moment, defending the entire science of animancy at a hearing before the Duke, absurd as it sounds. If it does not go well, it could be the end of animancy in Deerwood. I fear Eivor may be swayed by all this unrest, irrational though it may be. We shall see. Farewell. I'm wondering if we'll be able to be privy to this hearing. I suppose we'll have to be arguing one way or the other. Check in here. This man's soul was torn asunder by a Bewick. As you can see, the patient is unresponsive, common after soul trauma. Oh, he's holding a class. The animancer places a small stone upon the patient's forehead. A portion of his soul was recovered near his body. We use this stone as a vessel for transfer. Can you hear me, Oswin? The patient's eyes slowly open before a panicked, wild expression washes over him. Oh, boy. Unfortunately, the extended dissociation has permanent side effects. The patient becomes more agitated, grunting and moaning as he tugs at his bonds. He's going to get loose and kill everyone. With further research, we're confident that we'll be able to rehabilitate patients like Oswin. I guess that's it. The table is set with an assortment of leaflets and booklets with titles like Practical Benefits of Animancy. Oh yeah, Soul Adjustment for the Well Adjusted Soul. There's nobles. Everlasting Life. Imagine the possibilities. I heard that someone who was treated here came out twice as smart. I wonder what all this equipment actually does.
What?
Let's see what lies this way.
He's not good enough at sneaking.
Eh?
Well, we'll talk to Audmer.
Good day to you.
A bald man with a crooked nose gestures in demonstration over the still body of a patient before a small gathering of interested onlookers. He's not still anymore. Feeling your gaze, he pauses his discussion. Have you come to sit in? What is it you do here? Close as we are to the Glanfathan Wilds, we get a number of Beowick maimings every year. Survivors dealing with complications from exposure. This fellow here is a severe case. His essence is a mere whisper of what it was. I am early in my research, only beginning to understand how they work, but in time I hope to find a way to protect people from the storm's effects. I wasn't done talking to you.
How do you do?
I'd like to know more about the sanitarium. He gives an eager nod. It's the mission that attracted me here. The treatment of the disturbed. No one seems to care about them. Here, they've worked wonders for them. I've seen people cured of insatiable hungers and uncontrollable urges. I've seen the crippled walk and the dysphoric smile, all within these walls. The thought that the Duke could put an end to it with a single order, it keeps me up nights. All right, we're done.
Eh?
Eh. Okay, we've got another room here and there and then stairs down. The craziest person is down there. That's what we heard. These look like field sketches of Ingwithin ruins and artifacts. Oh goody, so we can actually look at something here. He's yelling hello. Adir Customs. Do I have that? Oh! Mm-hmm. Every once in a while, the The voices do that. It's so weird. Endear customs. The brownish or tannish book, wasn't it? I think we might have it. Yep. Damn it. We can stop sneaking. There's too many people over there. We can't do anything. This painting of a rolling forest glen has a strangely soothing effect. Alright, let's head down. Oh boy. This. Right. Okay.
Time to see and not be seen.
Fog of War means sneak. Here be insane people. Hail, Belisage.
Good day to you.
A woman paces back and forth, her feet crunching on the soft red carpet. She gestures and mumbles to herself, shaking her head as she pores over pages of notes. She almost walks into you. Ekosi, here I am, looking so hard for answers in my research that I do not see the Kith standing in front of me. What can I do? What do you do here? According to my research grant, I study awakenings. Sublimating pre-awakened souls has been one of Animancy's greatest successes, and I am working on a method to replicate the process on awakened souls. She gnaws at her lip. Are you really? I thought you were an inmate here. But the truth is that I find few suitable subjects here. Widewind's legacy has left plenty of awakened souls, but most are too broken for study. I fear I will return to Revua with nothing to show for my efforts. Do we want to be telling her this? She's going to experiment on us. I'm awakened. I've been recalling flashes of a past life. She scratches her chin. Most interesting, but not the kind of awakening I can study, I'm afraid. Whew. I need someone whose awakened soul can be triggered with predictable stimuli. Souls such as these tend to manifest as alternate personas in the host. She gives you a broad, if strained, smile, but I thank you for the offer. Something else you need? I'd like to know more about animancy in the Valian Republics. It's a dynamic and respected field. Even the Bale Reach incident did little to slow it. She shrugs. People in the Republics are more accepting of risk, less superstitious, ready to try anything that shows promise. People should turn to the gods for answers. The gods help those who help themselves. Otherwise, we would all pray for our coppers. Okay. This strange device seems to thrum with power. There must be some danger here if we're... I can't close that door.
Hello? Hello?
Kanna, shut up. Modred. An animancer scrabbles feverishly on a parchment scroll while his free hand dances through the air, counting off unseen objects. His lips move in silent discourse. As your shadow falls over his scroll, he looks up at you with mingled perplexity and irritation.
Good day, stranger.
Can I help you? He forces a polite smile. What are you working on? My area of focus is wicks, more specifically how to cure them. I'm not sure how to say that, guys. What's a wicked? A hollowborn who's received a transplanted animal soul during infancy. That's what it is? Animal souls are going into people? So where are the people's souls going? Into animals? Really? Or no, that's their... Okay. That's not the legacy, that's their attempt to cure the legacy. One of Animancy's early efforts to cure the legacy, if not a successful one. That's kind of fascinating, actually. He removes his spectacles and wipes his brow. They show signs of developmental abnormalities throughout their childhood, but when they reach adolescence, they become aggressive, feral, but still victims in need of care. Transplanting animal souls into children seems like an odd solution. We Animancers are trying to do something about the crisis, better than letting it swallow a generation of children. He stares at a fixed point on the far wall, and despite the controversy, it only went so far because, at first, it seemed to work. People called it the salvation. Children that had never been responsive to any kind of stimuli suddenly seemed aware of their surroundings, of their families. We are the animals inside. He takes a slow breath. The complications don't begin until puberty, but that's when the incompatibilities between body and soul take shape. Children become violent, ravenous. But we paid dearly for our mistake, I promise you. Angry mobs hunted down animancers and burned down their homes, with them still inside, often as not. People took to calling it the cruel salvation, and many still loathe us for it. But we wanted to stop the legacy as much as anyone. The public begged for our help, and we did the best we could. I still don't know if that absolves us. Why do you study Wicks? What kind of question is that? Just think of all the families that could be healed, the lives that could be restored. What could be more important? His face has reddened, and he turns away from you a moment. He shakes his head. Animancy has an answer here. I know it. It's simply a matter of working it out. I see. Good. I'm just looking around. Then be quick about it, and don't touch anything. The sanitarium has a lax visitor policy, but I don't. Without another word, he resumes his work. Unexpected results. The canine host was listless and unresponsive, but it was determined that this was simply the implanted feline soul. Yarn resulted in vigorous simulation. That's funny.
Light, flame, and sound. We'll keep to ourselves.
Eh?
Let's try.
Shh. You can trust me.
In a corner of Mildred's lab rests a large, weathered trunk. It seems likely to contain something important, if only by virtue of its size. I wonder if he was spotted at this point, but... Examine the trunk more closely. Nothing grabs your attention except for the large padlock on the front. Whatever this animancer keeps in here, he does not want anyone else to have or see. Let's open it. I gotta open it. A heavy lock holds the trunk shut. It's too sturdy to break, and the mechanism looks too complicated to pick. You'll need to find the key.
Margrin's fire casts light in dark places.
It's just... gold here. Let's move on.
Eh?
I'm still sneaking because...
Slow and silent.
Oh. Hello. I never thought I'd be taking orders from a talking statue. If you're here as a client, you'll want to be talking to an animancer, not me. There's no one in this one, huh? The edges of the cage are dented and scored with claw marks. Well, yeah, this is where they kept the animals. Kind of disappointed we can't ever close the door again. Unlocking this will require the proper key. Hey! We need a key in here. I don't know if we're supposed to kill people to get it.
Greetings.
Or what. There's only one other person we can ask about this. Nope. Damn! I want to get in there, and in there. Okay, apparently we're done. Andra's gift. Okay, that will definitely be next episode. Right into Andra's gift, the last district, which is not overrun by zombies, apparently. Go here. It won't highlight because I haven't clicked on that thing. And that's full of zombies, apparently. Oh, that looks spooky as hell. It'll look like a mansion covered with cobwebs. Okay, so stay tuned for next episode when we explore Andra's gift. Endure in enduring, grow strong.